How many years? 34 wonderful years, right? Unbelievable years. Miss Cody's sitting there like, oh, wait, you're going to get him in trouble. No, I'm just kidding. I know that you guys have a great marriage, great relationship. I appreciate you guys being here. And even though this isn't your guys' home church, you guys have visited us a number of times as well. And we appreciate you and Chris and Caitlin as well. Let's go ahead and get right into the message before I get myself in trouble, all right? 3 John, look at verse number 4 again. The Bible says, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. Now, we are continuing our theme, Walking in Truth, for 2014, and we only have 2 months left talking about this theme. I want to encourage you, be faithful over the next 2 months. Try to be here every Sunday morning. And I'm excited about our theme for next year. We've got 2 more months with this theme, but I am really excited about next year and our theme for next year. And so be here, be excited, be faithful. And remember, walking in truth, as we've talked about, that the walking part is relating to your life, your lifestyle, how you live. When John here wrote this letter and he said, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. What he was saying is, I have no greater joy than to hear that they're living the truth, that their lifestyle reflects the truth. And remember, as we've seen many times before, the truth is the word of God, because Jesus said, talking about God's word, thy word is truth. And so we know that when we use that phrase walking in truth, it's referring to living a life in accordance with God's word, or living a life that reflects the teachings and the principles of God's word. That's what God wants for you this morning. But remember, he addressed this letter in verse number 1. He says, unto the elder and the well-beloved. Remember, most importantly, God wants you to know him as your heavenly father. He wants you to know his son, Jesus, as your savior. He wants you to have the peace in your heart that comes from being saved, and that is provided by the Holy Spirit of God when he comes to live inside you. That happens the day that you receive Christ, or you are born again, as the Bible talks about. And the Holy Spirit comes to live inside you and stay inside you. And that's what he wants more than anything. If you do not know where you're going to spend eternity, let me tell you, the Bible addresses that topic. The Bible clearly states that there are two places, heaven and hell, and that God doesn't want anyone to go to hell. But because of our sin, and because we are imperfect, God cannot allow imperfect, sinful man into heaven. Therefore, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die, to shed his blood for our sins, to pay for our sins, so that we could have entrance into heaven, so that we can go to heaven when we die. Being a member of this church, being baptized in a church, being a good person, those are good things, but those will not get you to heaven. Only knowing Jesus Christ as your Savior will get you into heaven. That's why Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. The only way into heaven is Jesus Christ. And you need to know that first and foremost. If you don't know that, then I want you for the next 15 minutes just to meditate on that thought. Do I know where I'm going when I die? And if you don't, in a few minutes when we have our invitation, I want to encourage you to come forward and to let someone show you from the Bible how you can go to heaven. Now, if you already know that, the rest of the message this morning is for you. Because here, as we've been talking about, God wants us to walk in truth. He wants our life to reflect his word and to be in accordance with his word, the Bible. Look back, if you would, for a second here to verse number 3. The Bible says here, for I rejoice greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth. We have been talking about various ways that you and I can live so that our lives will line up with the word of God. We've talked about praying. We've talked about reading our Bible. We've talked about being in church whenever the church doors are open. We've talked about telling other people about the Lord Jesus Christ, listening to and watching things that please him and abstaining from those things that don't. We've covered a myriad of topics. This morning, I want to give you a reason why we should walk in truth. Now, obviously, the most important reason is God. He's our Heavenly Father. If you're a Christian, you're born again, then he's your Heavenly Father, and you want to please him. But there's another reason, a very, very important reason. Here in verse number 3, John said, notice there at the beginning of the verse, "For I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee." Another reason why we should live according to God's word is because others who are saved see our lifestyle, see our testimony, and they are either encouraged from it or discouraged because of it. I don't know about you this morning, but I don't want to discourage anybody. That is not my hope. That is not what I am trying to do with my life. I don't want to discourage my wife. I don't want to discourage my children. I don't want to discourage my church members. That's not my goal. My goal is to encourage, or the Bible uses the word edify, which means to build up. As I've said before, there are so many things in this world that tear people down. All you've got to do is turn on TV for a few minutes and, man, people are just constantly tearing one another down. I don't want to tear anybody down this morning, but I do want the Word of God to be used to challenge you and to convict you, if necessary, to be a better person, to live your life more according to God's Word. Why? Because God wants it. Because other Christians are watching you, and they are either encouraged by you or discouraged because of you. But then third, and this is the real reason that I want to focus on this morning, because there are those who don't know Jesus Christ as Savior, and they are watching you. Turn with me, if you would, over to the book of Matthew. I want to just show you three things about walking in truth and how we should walk towards those that the Bible says are without. Matthew, and look with me, if you would, at chapter number 14. Matthew chapter number 14. We're going to see three things real briefly here this morning. Matthew chapter number 14, walking towards them that are without. Now, you're going to see that phrase here in a few verses that we're going to look at, them that are without. And what is it referring to? It's those, or them that are without hope, them that are without peace, them that are without the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. As you've heard me say many times before, I became a Christian at the age of 16. I received Jesus Christ as my Savior. Before that time, before December 1st, 1993, if I had died, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, I would have gone to hell because I didn't know Jesus as my Savior. And it was the preaching of the Word of God that caused me to evaluate my life and look at my situation and realize that no matter how good I was, I couldn't get to heaven. Remember, when I got saved, I was in church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. I was in charge of a bus route as a 16-year-old young boy. I was in charge of a bus route that went around our town in Iowa, picked people up, and brought them to church. I went out every Thursday night, Saturday morning, and knocked on doors and invited people to come to church. I was trying to read my Bible. I was trying to pray, but I was missing one thing. I was without one thing. That was Jesus Christ. And the day I got saved, December 1st, 1993, I got the saving knowledge that Jesus Christ can give, and only Jesus Christ can give. And so when that phrase, you'll see it here in a moment, is used, it's talking about those who do not know Jesus this morning. Those people may be people outside of this building. They may be people who got up this morning and they didn't go to church. But they could also be people that are sitting inside a church. Can I tell you there's many people sitting inside churches this morning that don't know Jesus Christ as Savior? That they've been told that if you go to church faithfully every Sunday, you'll get to heaven, which is totally contradictory to the Word of God, where the Bible says in Ephesians 2, 8, 9, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves." It is a gift is something that's free. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. There are many people sitting in churches this morning, and they don't know Jesus Christ as Savior. For that reason, God wants us to walk in truth. For them that are without, towards them that are without, so that they'll see Jesus in us. Matthew chapter number 14, and look at verse number 13. Matthew chapter number 14, and look at verse number 13. The Bible says, "When Jesus heard of it, he departed thence by ship into a desert place apart. And when the people had heard thereof, they followed him on foot out of the cities. And Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick." Now, here in this passage of Scripture, we don't have time to read the entire passage, but this is where Jesus, of course, took the loaves of bread and he took the fish and he blessed them and he then fed 5,000 people. Before feeding the 5,000 people, before this miracle ever occurred, Jesus saw these people and he was moved with compassion. He had compassion toward them. This morning, the first thing I want to challenge you to do is to have compassion toward them that are without. To have compassion towards others who do not know Jesus Christ as Savior. On Wednesday night, as we've been studying the book of Ephesians, we were talking about pride and how that pride creeps into everyone's life, and everybody battles with pride. If you say, I don't have a battle with pride, then you're lying to yourself, which is a prideful statement. To lie to someone is a prideful thing to do. Every one of us battles with pride. You either battle with pride or conceit or vanity or self-pity. Every one of us battles with it. Some of us may be winning the battle over it today. To God be the glory for that. But everybody battles with it. And the Bible tells us here that Jesus had compassion on these people. He looked at them and he had compassion for them. He did not think he was better than them. And he had compassion for them. On Wednesday night, as we were talking about pride, I said that unfortunately in Christianity, there has been, I guess what you could call a spiritual pride that has arisen. It's really an oxymoronic statement because pride is not a spiritual thing, but it's a carnal thing. It's like saying sweet and sour sauce. It's sweet and it's sour. It doesn't happen. That's an oxymoronic statement. And so to say that someone has spiritual pride is oxymoronic, but that's really what's happened is people who know Jesus Christ as Savior, many of them have gotten lifted up in pride because they know the Lord, because they know they're going to heaven when they die. They look down on people who do not. They look at the things going on in this world, and they look at these other people that are doing foolish things, that are living foolishly, and they start thinking to themselves, I'm glad I'm not like that guy. I'm glad I'm not like that lady. I'm glad I'm better than them. This morning, I'm not better than anybody. And you've heard me say the statement over and over again, I am not better, but because I know Jesus as my Savior, I am better off. That means that I have it already settled. I'm going to heaven when I die, and I praise God for that. That was all because he gave his son to die for me, and I did nothing to deserve that. I did nothing to earn that. I'm better off this morning than I was when I was 16 years of age and I didn't know Jesus Christ as my Savior. But I am not better than anybody else. I'm not better than the drug addict. I'm not better than the whoremonger. I'm not better than the drunkard. I'm not better than anybody else. I may be better off, but I'm not better. When people start thinking that they're better, they lose compassion. They lose compassion for others. This morning, as a Christian, do you still have compassion for them that are without? For those that don't know Christ as Savior? Remember what it was like to not know Jesus as your Savior? Remember what it was like before you became a Christian? How that you worried about where you were going to spend eternity? You were fearful that you might die and go to hell. And then the peace that flooded your soul when you received Jesus Christ as your Savior. Hey, remember those people that are doing wrong, that don't know Jesus as their Savior. Hey, they have that same fear that you once had. They have that same doubt that you once had. This morning, you don't have it. Praise be to God for that. You're not better than them. You're better off. And for that reason, have compassion on them. See them in their need and have compassion for them. Now, with all that said, compassion will drive you to do something about their situation. A compassionate person doesn't say, oh man, I see that this person is dying and going to hell, and so I'll pray for them. That's all I'm going to do is pray for them. They'll say, you know what? I'm going to try to tell them about Jesus Christ. I'm going to put some feet behind my faith, and I'm going to actually do something about it. I'm going to let them know that there is hope. If that person decides not to trust Christ, that's their decision. But hey, have some compassion and try to tell them about the Lord. Take your Bibles with me. Let's look at the second thing real quickly. Colossians. Turn over to the book of Colossians, chapter number 4. Colossians, chapter number 4 and verse number 5. Colossians, chapter number 4, verse number 5. The second thing real quickly here. Paul writes, walk in wisdom toward them that are without. Redeeming the time. If you look before this, he starts out this chapter in verse number 1. He writes, masters, give unto your servants that which is just and equal, knowing that ye also have a master in heaven. And then he goes on to talk about prayer in verses 2 and 3 and 4. And then in verse number 5, he uses that phrase, walk in wisdom toward them that are without. Not only do I want to encourage you to be compassionate towards them, but I want to encourage you to walk in wisdom toward them that are without. He says, redeeming the time. We talked about that, how that we need to redeem the time, which means take the time that God has given to us. You may have 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 years. You don't know. I don't know. But take the years that God gives to you and use them for His honor and for His glory. Don't waste the time that He's given you here on this earth. Don't use it for selfish means. Take it and use it so that those that don't know Jesus Christ as Savior will know. Can I tell you, looking back at my life so far, and I know I joke with you, and I just joked with you a few moments ago about being old at the age of 37. But honestly, at the age of 37, and my wife and I have talked about this a number of times, I don't know too many people, Brother Hughes, that have done more things or seen more things than myself or my wife. I mean, think about it. If you're older than 37, think of where you were when you were 37. Think of what you had seen and what you had done. Now, some of you that joined the military, you saw a lot. You got to experience a lot, probably. But a lot of people grow up and they spend their life in the same town or in the same estate all their life. By the time my wife and I went to Ukraine, 10 years ago, we went to Ukraine. I would have been 27. We had already seen the majority of the 50 United States. My wife, because of her dad being in the military, got to see or was able to see much of Europe. When we went over to Ukraine, we were able to fly through France and see some of France, and we saw some of Germany and Switzerland. We saw a lot of things. At the age of 37, now being back here in California and looking back and seeing how that we were able to go over to a foreign country, learn the Russian language, help plant a church that is now flourishing on its own with a national pastor. Man, I look back and say, man, I have got to see a lot happen. God has been good to me. I look at it and I say, man, I don't think I would have spent the last 21 years of my life, which is the day I got saved, I was 16 and I'm 37 now. I don't think I would have spent the last 21 years of my life any differently than in the service of the King, because I've been able to see so much and experience so much. Can I tell you, a lot of people, they say, I would serve God, I would live for God, but I want to do this while I'm young. I want to do this with my life. And God says, hey, you give me your life and I'll prolong your days on the earth. I'll give you what you can't give yourself. I'm telling you what, folks, I have a lot of people I grew up with in public school that they are still living in the same town I grew up in Podunk Holler, Iowa. They're still living there. They haven't seen as much as I've seen. They haven't been as blessed as I can say. I'm blessed not because I'm anything great, but because He is great. And He promises if you walk in wisdom towards them that are without, you will redeem the time. He'll take the time that you have, that time that is so precious and so little, and He'll bless you with more, and He'll bless you even greater than you could imagine. With all that said, in verse number 6, he says, let your speech be always with grace. We need to make sure that our words are wise words. Make sure this week that as you're out there, you speak like a wise man and not a fool. I'm surprised at how often I turn on the TV, and you've heard me say before how much I love sports, and I watch sports, and I listen to these guys after the game, and they sound like fools. I mean, they sound like fools. I wouldn't want them teaching my kids in public school. They don't sound like they know anything about life except how to catch a football or how to hit a baseball. And you and I know there's so much more to life than that. Hey, at the same time, as a Christian, I need to be careful with what I say, because what I say can be viewed as wise or as foolish. And you can't take the words back once you've spoken them. Once you've yelled at that person, because as you've heard me say many times before, they cut you off on the freeway. You can't get those words back, and you can't get that testimony back. Hey, that person that was rude with you, maybe as you were waiting to go through the checkout at the grocery store, you say one wrong thing to them. You say one mean or rude thing to them. You can't get that back. God wants to use you, but you have to walk wisely. I have to walk wisely towards them that are without. Last verse. Turn over to 1 Thessalonians real quickly. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. First Thessalonians chapter number 4 and verse number 12. And we talked about this yesterday in the men's breakfast. In verse number 11, actually back in verse number 10, let me start reading there. First Thessalonians 4:10, the Bible says, "And indeed ye do it toward all the brethren which are in all Macedonia. But we beseech you, brethren, that ye increase more and more." Paul says to the Thessalonians, you guys have been doing good. You've been doing good towards them that are Christians, them that are saved. And he says, but I want to beseech you. That means beg you. I want to beg you to increase more and more. And then he goes on in verse number 11 and says, "And that ye study to be quiet and to do your own business and to work with your own hands as we commanded you." In other words, I want you to have a good testimony. You don't need to be out there causing a ruckus, bringing a reproach on the name of Jesus. He says, just make sure that you're doing right. Make sure that when you go to work, you're a good worker. You work hard. You bring a good testimony to the name of Christ, and you don't bring a bad testimony to the name of Christ. And then he goes on in verse number 12, and look what he says, "That ye may walk honestly toward them that are without, and that ye may have lack of nothing." Honestly. Let me encourage you to walk honestly towards them that are without. We were talking about it yesterday in the men's breakfast with the city council and the mayor and all that's going on with the elections coming up. Brother Davis and I were out door knocking and talked to a gentleman that I know very well. And he was talking about someone that was running for city council. And he said, I asked him, I said, "Why do you support this individual?" Because I honestly haven't been able to keep up with a lot of these individuals and what they believe or where they stand on political issues. And I said, why do you have a sign for this individual in your front yard? They said, "Well, they're a believer. They're a God-fearing person." And I said, "That's great." And then the person then went on to say, "I mean, they lie sometimes, but you know, everybody does that, but they're a God-fearing person." And I told the man yesterday, I said, those are also statements that are contradictory. If you fear God, which means that you reverence God, you won't be known as a liar, or you shouldn't be known as a liar. Because someone who fears God, who reverences God, knows that God's with them. And when they're getting ready to lie, God, they remember that. And they, instead of lying, they tell the truth. Even though it may be to their dismay, even though it may be to their hurt, they're going to tell the truth. Remember when you were a kid and your mom or your dad caught you doing something? They didn't know what you were doing, but they knew you were doing something wrong. And they asked you about it. You had an opportunity to either tell the truth or to lie. What happens whenever we tell lies? Usually the hole gets deeper and deeper, especially when you start getting older, because you forget the lie that you told before to cover up for the lie that was before that. Sometimes with my kids, when I talk to them, if they tell me the truth, even if they did something that they know they weren't supposed to do, I'll let them off, because I'll tell them, "I'm glad that you at least told the truth. It was wrong what you did, but I'm glad you told the truth." Instead of compounding that and continuing to make it worse and worse. Folks, Christians ought not be known as liars. Believers ought to be known as honest people. I tell the truth. That's what people ought to say about me. Pastor Miller tells the truth. The people of Victory Baptist Church, they're honest people. You can trust them. I'll close with this. As we were over in Ukraine, I remember that so many things were done off of word of mouth over there. You know, now everything's done on paper here in the United States. But there was a day and age in which everything was done by word of mouth, by a shake of the hand, and that's how it was done over in Ukraine. And I always remember people telling me, "You can trust me. I'm telling you the truth." And I remember we would go down to, and I've told this before, but we would go down to the what was known as Souvenir Street there in Kiev. And Brother Hudson and I would go down there looking for something, and a lot of times they didn't know that we knew English, because we would talk to him in Russian, and his Russian was so good they thought he was Ukrainian for sure. And so I'd let him do the talking, and we'd be down there and we'd hear them trying to talk to people in English that were foreigners, maybe from England or from other countries, because English is spoken in so many countries. And you would hear these people as they were looking at the souvenirs, and the Ukrainians would say, I give you good deal, this is good deal. And then they would tell them how much they're going to give them. And they say, normally for other people, this is price, but for you, this is price. And they would tell them. And then we would go up to them and ask them the price in Russian. And they would give us a lower price than the people they were talking to in English. And I would always be leery of those people that would say, "You can trust me. I friend. I'd say, "Yeah, I know better. If you're speaking to me in English, I ain't trusting you. If you speak to me in Russian. Remember when Brother and Mrs. Davis came and visited us that first time, and we were going to get a taxi and go down to one of the squares. And we got down there, and Brother Davis, he ran up to a taxi, and he got the guy to give him a price. And he comes back, he goes, hey, I went over to this guy, and I got a good price. I said, did you talk to him in English? Of course, I knew he talked to him in English. But I said, did you talk to him in English? He goes, yeah. I go, we're not going with that guy then. Why? Because I knew the price was going to be higher. Man, so many people are dishonest anymore. That's not just Ukrainians. It's probably more so Americans than Ukrainians or any other nationality. Man, people ought to know you're a Christian, and so therefore you're honest. They can trust you. You're truthful. Why? Because once again, they're watching you this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all that you've done for us. Thank you for all that you've given to us. Lord, I pray that you'd forgive me if I labored too long in one area this morning. Father, I wanted to use the time that you gave me and that these folks have given up. I wanted to use it wisely, and I pray that it was used wisely. Father, I pray that you would speak to hearts now and challenge us and stir us as only you can. In Jesus' name, with heads bowed, real quick.